are making a commitment to community with Dr. Anne Klaeysen. Anne is the leader here at the New York Society for Ethical Culture. She holds a Doctor of Ministry degree in pastoral counseling from Hebrew Union College, as well as master's degrees in German from the State University of New York at Albany and business administration from New York University. She is the ethical humanist religious life advisor at Columbia University, humanist chaplain at NYU, and co-dean of the Humanist Institute. Anne also serves on the board of Sunday Assembly NYC and participates in several interfaith and social justice coalitions. Dr. Klaeysen.
Thank you, Dan. And thank you for playing Somewhere, because I love that song, and of course the words, we'll find a new way of living, we'll find a way of forgiving, are so, so very important. Well, before I leap into my first poem, I just want to show you that I am wearing a white pantsuit. I cannot tell you for whom to vote. However, I can show you for whom I will be voting. And not only is it a white pantsuit, but also has the colors from the ERA, the Equal Rights Amendment, from the suffragette movement. And I hail from Seneca Falls, that area of Seneca Falls. And so this is a very important time for us. And the last time I wore this pantsuit, actually, was when I was in Washington, D.C., marching and rallying for the Equal Rights Amendment. We still do not have equal rights in this country. So bear that in mind when you go to the polls on Tuesday. This is a poem by Wendell Berry. I love Wendell Berry. Not only is he's a poet and an essayist, but he's also a farmer in Kentucky. And so much of what he writes comes out of that experience of being close to the land. We clasp the hands of those who go before us and the hands of those who come after us. We enter the little circle of each other's arms and the large circle of lovers whose hands are joined in a dance, and the larger circle of all creatures passing in and out of life, who move also in a dance to a music so subtle and vast that no ear hears it except in fragments. So, you see up here, I am because we are, and this is where I take my inspiration. And this is the sense of Ubuntu. And as you can see here, this was a story. An anthropologist proposed a game to children of an African tribe. He put a basket near a tree and told the kids that the first one to reach the fruit would win them all. When he told them to run, they all looked at each other, they took hands, and they ran together. And they sat together enjoying the fruits. When asked why they ran like that, as one could have taken all the fruit for oneself, they said, Ubuntu. And that is how each one of us can be happy. Because how can one person be happy if others are sad? So I take that as the theme for this morning. We are because each one of us is. I am because you are and because we are. This is the kickoff, the luncheon later is the kickoff for our 2017 Fair Share Giving campaign. And when we talk about fair share, we talk about making a very real commitment to community. So what is it that commitment requires of us? It's when you're willing to give your time and energy to something that you believe in. It's a promise and a firm decision to do something. To do something. Felix Adler, our founder, whose portrait hangs over there, referred to different spiritual pains. And one of them was feeling overwhelmed by the great need and suffering in the world. And knowing that we can't solve everything, that we can't bind up every wound, that we can't fill every belly. And he said, even though we have that pain, we can do something. Choose to do something. Choose to join with other people who also wish to do something about the suffering, the fear, the hunger, the poverty, the hate in the world. Commitment is also a strong belief that something is good and you should support it. Something is good. Well, again, ethical culture has something we call a supreme ethical rule. And I recently videotaped a sermonette on that because one of our past speakers, Robert Wright, who wrote The Moral Animal, among other books, and is spending another year at Union Theological Seminary, has a website that he calls Meaning of Life. And so he calls upon different people to give a one-minute sermonette. What's the meaning of life? Well, that strong belief in goodness demonstrates itself in our practice of eliciting the best. We choose to attribute worth and dignity to every human being, and we choose to act in ways that bring out that goodness. And when we do that, we bring out the goodness in ourselves as well. I'm going to give you an example of that. Yesterday, President Obama was at a rally. And there was someone there who did not agree with him and did not agree with the other people who were there supporting one of the candidates. He supported the other candidate. And people were upset about this. And President Obama, not only as our nation's leader, but also as a moral leader, said, hold on, hold on. This man deserves our respect. He chose to attribute worth and dignity to the one person at that rally who was disagreeing with everybody else. He deserves our respect. Look at him. He's not hurting anybody. And look at him. He seems a little older than some of you. He's an elder and deserves our respect. And look what he's wearing. It appears to be a military uniform. Well, certainly he deserves respect for that as well. And so don't boo, vote. He demonstrated seeing the good in another person, even a person who disagreed with him, and encouraged everyone to do that as well. So a commitment is a strong belief to something that is good. Commitment is an enthusiasm for something and a determination to work for it. Well, I don't work with many people who are more enthusiastic than this crowd. And your president, Liz Singer, often talks about the passion that she sees in the members, and that her role as president is to engage that passion that you all have. So I know that all of you have a commitment and an enthusiasm for something, and you're determined to work hard at it. Look at how all of you determined to be here today. And that was no mean feat, because you were asked to stop and maybe open up your bags and show your ID. and to say, oh, I'm going over there. That's my ethical community. I need to get there and nothing's going to stop me. Nothing and no one is going to keep me from spending Sunday with my community. So congratulations to all of you. Finally, commitment is a duty or a responsibility that you have accepted. And so whether you're here for the first time and you're exploring what ethical community could be and what we're all about, or whether you are longtime members, you're accepting a responsibility. You've accepted that responsibility to support this community, knowing that it gives you a voice in the larger community. It expresses your values in the larger community. You have not only your individual voices, but by virtue of you belonging to a community, you have a larger voice. And sometimes that expresses itself in the banner that we have out on Central Park West. So today, people going down, maybe they're runners and their families, they're seeing that women's rights are human rights, because that's one of the banners that we display. We also have others that we bring out from time to time. What is the definition of community? Well, you all shared during the sharing time what your definition of community is. I'm going to give you a couple. This is from the Oxford Dictionary. A group of people living in the same place or having a particular characteristic in common. A group of people living together, especially practicing some common leadership. It might be also a body of nations or states that are unified. It could be in a particular district, like we're going to be going to our district places to vote on Tuesday. It's also a feeling of fellowship with others, because we share common attitudes and interests and goals. This is something that ethical culture has provided for 140 years, bringing people together from different backgrounds, from different faiths, or from no faiths, and suggesting that there really is another way of living. There really is another way of forgiving. There really is a way to respect one another's beliefs or lack of beliefs and find common ground in ethics. Getting back to Mobutu, Desmond Tutu said, I am a human because I belong. I participate. I share. In essence, I am because you are. A person with Mobutu is open and available to others, affirming of others, does not feel threatened that others are able and good, based from a proper self-assurance that comes from knowing that she or he belongs in a greater whole and is diminished when others are humiliated or diminished, when others are tortured or oppressed. Adler's ethical philosophy, which can be a little difficult to understand, but in practice, I think, works so well for us, is that he talks about an organic whole, an organic ideal of humanity, wherein the fact that we are different is what holds us together. The fact that we are unique and that we need each other's differences and unique qualities hold us together. This is the opposite of tribalism. It's the opposite. And sadly, what we've been experiencing, lo, these almost 2 years now, is a kind of tribalism where people are going into their separate circles, and somehow it doesn't make me feel better that it's been going on, that in 1830 he recognized that as well, because I would have hoped that we would have outgrown that kind of immaturity. I would have hoped that we had learned to see each other and to celebrate those differences. And to know that it not only takes two parties in this particular democracy, but even more parties and more opinions and more ways of living that we share with one another. Not this devolution that we're experiencing, this tribalism that we're experiencing. And so in ethical culture, in ethical humanism, we turn that upside down and inside out, and we say what we most need are those differences. What we most need are ways to listen to them, those differences, in ways that are not threatening to us, but are in ways from which we can learn and develop and grow. That's what community does at its best. Sharon Welch, who's written a great deal about organizing groups and communities, she wrote that an appropriate symbol for the process of celebrating life, enduring limits, and resisting injustice is what she called the beloved community. The beloved community. The beloved community names the matrix within which life is celebrated. Love is worshiped. And partial victories over injustice lay the groundwork for further acts of criticism and courageous defiance. From within the matrix of beloved community, there is a solid basis for social critique and self-criticism. The life-giving love constitutive of solidarity with the oppressed and love of oneself. So yes, critique. It's the lozenge. We can critique society and injustices, but we don't condemn. Big difference between critiquing and condemning. Wayne Muller also writes a great deal about community. We are called to be strong companions and clear mirrors to one another, to seek those who reflect with compassion and a keen eye how we are doing, whether we seem centered or off course. We need the nourishing companion of others to create the circle needed for growth, freedom, and healing. That mirroring part, that seeing oneself in the other, in being able to hear the criticism, when we're off center, what can bring us back to center? We're hearing a lot about Native Americans these days and standing up and supporting the Standing Rock Sioux tribe in North Dakota. There's another community of Native Americans called the Navajo. I'm sure you're familiar with them as well. I actually became familiar with them because it's a wonderful detective series, and I love detective series, especially in stressful times like these. So there are some Navajo Indian detectives, and one theme they keep coming back to, whether they're trying to find out who committed a crime, addressing some injustice, is what's called the blessing way. And the blessing way is done with someone who has strayed in some fashion. And you call the person back into a restorative circle and repeat the blessing way. And you turn to everyone in your circle and you hear all the good things that you have done. All the good things. So the person who has transgressed and harmed the community is called back into the community to hear a recitation not only of the blessing way, but also of all the good things he has done to be brought back into the community. Not to be put outside, not to be isolated, not to be condemned, but to be restored to the community. We're all looking for ways to belong. And in our culture today, we hear a lot about identity politics. When I'm on the Columbia or NYU campuses, they also have an opening go-round, as we do here. But there, you express your identity. So it would be, my name is Anne, I'm a cis female, straight, married, however I wish to identify my relationships. I'm a chaplain here, this is my role. And the pronoun that I'm comfortable with is she and her. So often we're understandably and rightly looking at our own identities and feeling comfortable in them. We need also to be able to hear the identities of other people and learn how to be comfortable with them as well. And offer the invitation into community. It's about walking that talk that we talk about here every Sunday. We're all longing to go home, to some place we have never been, and a place half remembered and half envisioned we can only catch glimpses of from time to time. And that's from Starhawk, also a Native American who's very inspiring. Community, somewhere. There are people to whom we can speak with passion without having the words catch in our throats. Somewhere, a circle of hands will open to receive us, eyes will light up as we enter, voices will celebrate us whenever we come into our own power. Community means strength that joins our strength to do the work that needs to be done. Arms to hold us when we falter, a circle of healing, a circle of friends, some place where we can be free. Last weekend, I participated in a symposium that took place here, and it was with two of our members, Judith Wallach and Bob Tapp, and other people involved in the Ethics in Education Network. And for that weekend, we formed a community of people who not only took ethics very seriously, but took teaching ethics and modeling ethics in our public schools very seriously, and understood that it wasn't about teaching some kind of characters or virtue or value ethics, but really empowering ourselves to listen deeply, to hear what needs to be done, and how we can be allies, and then to do it. And to understand that every situation we find ourselves in is an opportunity to engage in ethics. So that's another thing that we cultivate here. Ethics is being cultivated here. Marge Percy is, I think, a favorite of many of us, a poet. And I think she puts in this poem, which is called The Low Road, the essence of how people come together. Two people can keep each other sane, can give support, conviction, love, massage, hope, sex. Three people are a delegation, a cell, a wedge. With four, you can play games and start a collective. With six, You can rent a whole house, have pie for dinner with no seconds, and make your own music. 13 makes a circle, 100 fill a hall, 1,000 have solidarity and your own newsletter. 100,000, a network of communities, 1,000,000, our own world. It goes one at a time. It starts when you care to act. It starts when you do it again. After they say no, it starts when you say we and know who you mean, and each day you mean one more. That's our lesson, I think. Some people make a circle and they keep some people out and they keep other people in. We have a choice to make a circle and keep making that circle bigger and bigger and bigger, and embrace as many people as we can. Well, we have a full afternoon ahead of us, so I'm going to wind this down. And you'll be hearing about the accomplishments of this community throughout the year, the goals that we have for the coming year. And of course, we'll be asking you to make a commitment to one of the four T's of membership. You know them: time, talent, treasure, and training. So we'll be talking about treasure during the luncheon and having some fun with that and singing some songs where we've altered the lyrics a bit to have fun with that. What's most important is who you are in community and how you embrace others, and in the ways in which this community expresses your values in the larger community. I'm also on the board of the Encampment for Citizenship. And one thing the teens say, right, Fabio? One thing the teens say as a result of that training is, I found my voice, I know how to use it, and I'm going to use it. We in this community have a voice, and we have a community that's able to voice this outside these walls, in the community, in the world. But the only way that we can continue to do that is with the generous, passionate, enthusiastic support of every individual member. And you decide for yourselves. You go through a process of ethical discernment in terms of how you balance those four T's. A little bit about politics, because we are voting on Tuesday. One of my political heroes is from Czechoslovakia, Václav Havel. And he said, genuine politics, every politics worthy of the name, the only politics I am willing to devote myself to, is simply a matter of serving those around us, serving the community, and serving those who will come after us. Its deepest roots are moral, because it is a responsibility expressed through action to and for the whole. That is both the best expression I have found for politics and for community. And on Tuesday, you will have an opportunity to exercise your right. And I sincerely hope that you understand that as a citizen in a democracy, in a participatory democracy, it doesn't begin and end with your vote. There's so much more to it, so much more to it. John Dewey said that education is not preparation for life, it is life itself. And one of the reasons that we held the symposium last weekend was to recognize and celebrate the centennial of his book, Democracy and Education. They go hand in hand, folks. they go hand in hand. Take care.